Hi everybody! My name is Vera van Bergijk and I'm a PhD student at the University of Twente. Today I will present you my research on modeling of wave overtopping flow over complex dike geometries, a case study of the afsluit dike. First, I want to tell you something about wave overtopping on grass cover dikes. An example can be seen in the figure to the left, where I have a dike consisting of a sandy core and a cover consisting of clay with grass vegetation on top. During storm, high waves run up the dike, flow over the dike crest and accelerate on the landward slope. And these overtopping waves are characterized by a flow velocity U that is maximum at the wavefront. These overtopping waves exert high forces on the dike cover, expressed by a normal stress normal to the dike profile and a shear stress parallel to the dike profile. These forces can lead to dike cover erosion, as schematized in the figure, and an example of field test in the Netherlands of dike cover erosion can be seen in the figure to the right. In this study, we look at complex dike geometries. We define a complex dike geometry as a dike that contains multiple transitions. We distinguish two types of transitions, transitions in cover type and transitions in geometry. It's important to study transitions because they can influence the hydraulic load and thereby the dike cover erosion. An example of a transition in cover type is a road on top of the dike crest, as shown in the figure to the left. Here, the cover type changes from grass to asphalt and back to grass again. These changes in bed roughness can lead to additional turbulence, increasing the hydraulic load at these transitions. Even the simplest dike geometries have a transition in geometry, as shown in the figure to the right. For example, the transition from the crest to the slope and from slope to a horizontal plane at the inner toe. What happens from the transition from the crest to the slope is that the wave can separate from the dike cover and reattach on the upper slope, where we get an additional load due to wave impact. At the inner toe, the water still wants to move downwards because of gravity, which can increase the load by jet impact. It's important to take these types of effects into account when we want to model complex dike geometries. Thus, if we want to model wave overtopping flow over a complex dike geometry, we need to take the effects of transitions into account. And questions that we raised are, how can we include transitions in models? And with these models, are we able to answer the question, what are the effects of transitions on the flow and dike cover erosion? Well, to answer these questions, we have developed two models that we will use in this study. They are schematized in the figure. First, we have developed a simple and fast analytical model. And with this model, we can compute the erosion during an entire storm. Next, we have also developed a detailed hydrodynamic model, which can provide us some insights on the hydraulic forces working on the dike cover. We have applied both models to the afsluit dike to try and answer the questions above. So first, some more information about our case, the afsluit dike. The afsluit dike is a dam between the Waddenzee and the Lake IJssel in the Netherlands. And a top view can be seen here to the figure to the left. The Waddenzee side is where the waves come from and is protected for wave impact by blocks and hard revetments. However, you can see that the crest and part of the lakeside slope are covered in grass, and a simplified side view can be seen here in the figure. We first have a grass-covered crest, then a grass-covered upper slope, followed by a berm with a biking path and a berm with two roads. Since we are mainly interested in grass cover erosion, we will only model the crest and the lakeside slope. So now I will tell you something about the analytical model that we use. We have developed new formulas for the flow velocity U along the dike profile. And we can change the cover type by adapting the friction factor F, and the geometry is included in the slope angle. And we can also include the length of the crest, the slope length, and the berm width. An example is shown in the figure, where we see that the flow velocity decreases over the crest for the first 5 meters because of bottom friction. And it increases on the slope because of gravitational acceleration. So for erosion, we say that erosion occurs when the load is larger than the strength. And in this simple case, we assume that the load is only determined by the flow velocity, and the strength is only determined by a critical flow velocity UC. So if we include the flow velocity UC in our model, we see that there is no erosion when our modeled flow velocity is below UC, and erosion when the modeled flow velocity is above UC. Now, in case of transitions, we need to extend this model. In this case, the load is not only determined by the flow velocity, but also by a turbulence parameter omega, which we can use to simulate the additional load at transitions. So an example is shown in a purple line, where we increase the turbulence parameter at the beginning of the domain because of a transition, for example, and now the load is determined by the purple line. Also, in this case, we can take variations in the critical flow velocity into account, shown in the red line. Now, in this case, we will get erosion in the green area, so just at the beginning of the profile and at the end of the profile. We have applied our model to the Oslai dike case, where you can see the profile in the top figure. The flow velocity stays constant for the crest, increases over the slope, decreases over the berm with the biking path, and shows a small increase in the middle slope between both berms. Again, the flow velocity decreases over the horizontal part of the berm and increases at the end of the profile with the slope. It's interesting to see that the flow velocity is not really affected by the changes in cover type between grass and asphalt. Next, we've computed the erosion depth during a storm for the Oslai dike case with two formulations for the turbulence parameter. First, we used a constant turbulence parameter, where you can show the results in orange. Most erosion occurs around the berm with the biking path. Next, we also used a formulation for the turbulence parameter that depends on the cover type and slope angle, so we can kind of simulate the effects of transitions. Again, most erosion occurs around the biking path, which you can see here. So just before the biking path, at the end of the upslope, and at the location of the middle slope. So although these turbulence formulations do not affect the location of most erosion, they affect the amount of erosion. So therefore, it's important to get this right in your models. Next, we have developed a detailed model for the overtopping flow in open foam. This model solves the Reynolds average Navier-Stokes equations using the inter-ISO foam solver. The cover type is modeled using a Nikuratse roughness height in our K omega SST turbulence model. It's a 2D vertical model with grid sizes of 5 by 3 centimeters, and the grid is generated from measurements of the dike profile, so also larger bumps and irregularities can be taken into account. From this model, we can get insights in the hydraulic forces working on the dike cover. Because the output covers the near bed flow velocity, the shear and normal stress, and also the pressure on the dike surface. Because this model is computational demanding, we cannot compute the erosion during an entire storm. But with this model, we can identify locations with a high hydraulic load, which are potential locations for cover erosion. So now I show you the model results of our open foam model for one overtopping volume. We go from bottom to top in the figure. In the bottom figure, you see the dike profile. Next, we have the pressure along the dike profile. And the pressure significantly increases at locations where the slope changes, around 3, 11, 16, and 17 meters. Next, we have the shear stress that increases along the slope and is maximum around 17 or 18 meters. Then it decreases and becomes quite small for the rest of the profile. The normal stress is zero for horizontal parts, but is large on the upper slope and in the middle slope. The flow velocity is large at the beginning of the profile, increases on the upper slope, and then decreases along the rest of the profile. Now, if we look at the location where these parameters are maximum, we can identify potential locations for erosion. The flow velocity is maximum at the lower half of the first slope. The normal stress and the shear stress are maximum at the middle slope. And the pressure is maximum at the end of the upper slope. From the model results, we can identify four vulnerable locations for dike cover erosion. First, we have the transition from the crest to the upper slope, where we saw a significant increase in pressure. Next, we have the upper slope, where the flow velocity is maximum, and we also saw a high normal and shear stress. Then we have location 3, the transition from the upper slope to the berm. Here we saw a significant increase in the pressure, and also this was the location where the pressure was maximum. In the analytical model, this was one of the locations where most erosion occurred. Then we have the middle slope, location 4, where we again see an increase in the pressure, and at this location the shear and normal stress are maximum. In the analytical model, this was the other location where we saw most erosion. What we can see is that these four locations are all geometric locations, either a slope change or a slope itself. And from this we conclude that roughness transitions are not vulnerable according to our model results. Finally, the conclusions from our study. So what we learned about modeling of transitions? Well, the effect of cover type can be taken into account by a fracture factor in our analytical model and a nuclear ductor roughness height in our open flow model. The geometry is included in our analytical model by adapting the slope, angle and length of the different elements. And in our open flow model, we just make the grid from the dike profile. The additional load at transitions is parameterized with a turbulence parameter omega in our analytical model. And in open flow model, we solve the turbulence using our K omega SST model. So what have we learned about the effects of transitions? Well, from our model results, we can see that the geometric transitions have a lot more influence on the flow than roughness transitions. But to get some conclusions in erosion, we need to improve the formulation for the turbulence parameter omega. Finally, I want to thank all our funders for this research. And if you want to contact me, you can find my contact details below.